So we're halfway through the season now, and I know you guys always look to me as the number one predictor on the internet. I don't think I've ever had a single prediction go awry. I always get them correct, especially in the Premier League. I can't keep this lie going any further. Am I a good predictor when it comes to the Premier League? No. Well, I'm okay with the Champions League, at least the group stage. Do I enjoy predicting? It's fun, yeah, but I think you guys get more out of it than I do. So let's take a quick look at how my predictions are doing, if there's any life in them, if they're dead already, and ones that I think will turn it around. I don't know about you guys, but January is hitting me pretty hard, man. I've got those January blues, so I want to do something a little more fun this week. More analytical slash opinion-based stuff coming later on in the week, so be sure to subscribe for plenty more current events, explainer videos, rivalry videos, and so much more from the world of football. All right. Let's go. Okay, so Brighton, I think two seasons in a row I had called for them to go down, but I've been super impressed with Graham Potter as a manager. Starting last season, that's when he started to impress me. And this year, despite not a ton of results going their way, they've been great to watch. They just need a striker to finish off their chances, and they'll be good. But where did I have them? And I think that Brighton are going to survive again and finish in the exact same spot as last season. 15th. Okay, not bad, but I wouldn't be surprised if they push a little further up the table. As of the time of recording this, they're in 16th, so that's not too shabby. Also, I just realized I haven't had a haircut since that video was filmed. By the way, we won't go over every team in detail, but I'll show you my full table at the end. I want to go over the more egregious predictions. But with the trajectory West Ham has been on these last few seasons, I think this may be the year that things catch up to them. And psych, I have them barely staying alive in 17. So I look behind the curtain here. I actually initially thought that West Ham would go down and change my mind while filming that video. I did not expect them to be this good at all. I thought they would have a similar situation to that of last season and would hang on by the skin of their teeth. But my God, has Moyes ever got this team playing? I'm sure this is the first of many gaffes that I will have along the way, such as with Sheffield. For me though, the loss of Dean Henderson will be the biggest loss for Sheffield, but I don't see it being too fatal for their season. Henderson won them points in the past, and Ramsdale does have the potential to do so as well as a young, talented keeper, but I don't see him replicating Henderson's form. Not quite, at least. Okay, so perhaps it was more fatal than expected, but I think Sheffield's biggest issue is the lack of goals. They are competing with Burnley to be the worst attacking team in the league, having played two more matches than Burnley, and scoring just one more goal. I have Sheffield sliding down two places to 11th. Man, I was duped by their season-long hot streak from last season, just as many people were. Maybe I let the ridicule from Blades fans get to my head a little bit because I had them going down last season, but honestly, I saw no reason to believe that they would be this bad, they'd have this much of a regression. I mean, not a single victory until mid-January, 5 points from 19 matches, and their victory only came when they were a man up against Newcastle and from a penalty. My God, brutal form from them. They're going to accumulate a lot of points from my match predictor league, and by a lot of points, that's a bad thing. It works like golf. They survived last season thanks to, in some degree, not entirely, Hawkeye technology failing in their match against Sheffield United. Of course, we don't know what would have happened had they gone behind there. They might have stormed back and scored once again. But regardless, even with the signing of Watkins, who I think will be a revelation this season, I think survival for Villa will be just beyond them this season, and Villa will finish in 18th.
Blunder!
Did not expect Villa to be so much better this year. Ross Barkley was a great addition, and Grealish has been incredible, one of the best creators and overall players in the league thus far, I think. They're falling behind in their matches played, but even with having played four matches less than other teams in some cases, they're doing incredibly well in mid-table and could move up to the European places if they continue on with the form they're in. I truly hope for their sake that this COVID outbreak doesn't kill their form because they were doing so well before. I mean, they are in great shape, 1 point behind Arsenal having played four matches fewer. That says a lot. Let's say they only win two of those four matches, and they're still in the top six. Incredible season from Aston Villa in comparison to last season. Ralf Hasenhüttl has done some great things with Southampton considering the scenarios he has found himself in, and a lot of credit has to go to the Southampton board for not sacking him when times got tough. And he continues to do great things. Some of the results have been superb. Here's looking at that win over Liverpool, and they've certainly excelled beyond what I thought they would have, I think. Let's double check. I don't see them going down, that's for sure, as Ralph and the boys will probably end up just dropping slightly on the basis of everyone around them improving more. Yeah, exactly. They currently sit in the top 10, and I actually think they have a good enough squad to stay there or thereabouts. I think that Leeds has some real quality in their squad and a real quality manager, and I can see them climbing up to 10th, maybe even higher if things really take off. Yeah, so they're currently struggling, man. In 12th at the moment, so this 10th place finish isn't out of reach by any means, but they're just so inconsistent and simply cannot defend to save their lives. That 3-0 against Crawley is horrible. Only West Brom has a worse defensive record than theirs, and if they don't sort that out soon, they'll be in big trouble, I think. Not big enough trouble, as in they will go down necessarily, but a 16th or a 17th place finish will be on the cards, and perhaps Bielsa walking away, as he is known to do. And then what? That said, they sort out that defense, and they're a great side. I have doubts about their attack, and to an extent in Ancelotti as a project manager, as opposed to one that refines an already great team. But if they are to succeed with him at the helm and after these signings, it wouldn't be at all out of place. It would check out. As for a place, by the way, I have them in 8th. So Everton is proving me wrong. I mean, we'll see if they can continue to mix it up in the top 6, which I think they might just do. And they do have a match or two in hand. Man, all of the postponements, by the way, make it extremely hard to see the true picture of the league. There's a lot of, well, if they win or whatever, but that's okay. Regardless, it's safe to say they're doing better than I thought they would be at this point. Let's see how they do in the latter half of the season, as they were terrible in the latter half of last season under Ancelotti. But it's a different side now. Some great investments were made, so let's see how they do. And Calvert-Lewin, by the way, doing way better than I expected. I don't know what it is about Leicester, but something about their second half of the season coupled with Brendan Rodgers' history scream Rodgers' disaster class for the 2021 season. I hope I'm wrong, because God knows why, but I have a soft spot for Brendan Rodgers, and I don't want to see Leicester suffer, but with the amount of competition for the top 10 this year, I see Leicester getting about 9th. I mean, with 18 matches under his belt, he is doing just fine. No sign of a disaster class just yet, but it was the latter half of their season, just like with Everton, as past Adrian mentioned, that really fucked them last time. They're actually playing Chelsea as I film this. So, editor Adrian, how did they do?
They won. 2-0.
But regardless of that fact, one result doesn't change anything when it comes to where I place them. I mean, technically, they are just a few losses away from 9th, given how tight the Premier League season is. But overall, my prediction in this moment is way off. I mean, without even seeing the result against Chelsea, they are ahead of Liverpool in the standings. All right, let's see how my Wolves prediction is shaping up. I do think that this incredibly talented squad has that added bit of experience, and if anything, will be even better than last year, at least in the cup competitions, because I have them in 7th. Once again, for the Premier League. But still, considering how much everyone has improved around them, 7th for Wolves, that's great. It would be great. Unfortunately, they are sitting in 14th at the moment. That said, they're 7 points off of 7th, as things stand. I think we are seeing just how influential Raul Jimenez is to Wolves' success, and not just for the goals he brings, but the role he plays in their build-up as well. Wishing him all the best. Apparently, he started doing some fitness training, and things are going well, but he's still a long way away from returning, apparently. So, 7th isn't out of reach yet, but their form's extremely uninspiring at the moment. Alright, let's get to the teams I thought would finish in the top 6 now. I like this United side, especially going forward. Yes, they have struggled to score from open play at times towards the end of last season, and I do find it difficult to completely trust that back line, but I think that Ollie will lead them to top 4 once again, and United will finish in 4th. Well, as of now, I think United have surpassed the expectations of most. I mean, sitting in 1st after 18 matches played, 3 points ahead of the defending champions Liverpool in particular, 2 ahead of Leicester, and City, though if City win their match in hand, they'll go clear at the top. But United have been pretty good. First, at pretty much the halfway point of the season. I mean, the first time they've been top of the table since 2018, I believe. Solid. Or the 2017-18 season, I should say. They have a good young team, and with some experience under his belt now, I think Arteta's Arsenal will climb as high as 5th. Well, things looked so good for Arsenal following the FA Cup triumph, then the Community Shield triumph, which I don't put much stock in, but anyway. Well, they fell off massively and had their worst start to a season since the mid-70s. Incredible drop-off. So as of now, Arsenal have 5 clean sheets on the trot and are looking much better. That win over Newcastle had some fluid attacking play. It is Newcastle, I know, but I think they will climb higher than their current standing. But I mean, as things stand, it's yet another prediction that is in jeopardy of being completely wrong. I think we'll see a lot more of Ryan Sessegnon this season. It could be his breakout for the club. Shipped off to Hoffenheim at the beginning of October. Didn't see that coming, but that's okay. This wasn't the season that he takes over. Maybe next season will be, as he was the Hoffenheim Player of the Month back in November. He's been doing fairly well there, so we'll see. As for the attack, with all of them healthy once again and with more time under Mourinho, I think Spurs will be a tough team and will be in the top 6 conversation all season long until they lock it down and finish in 6. So this video was made before the Bale and Vinicius signings, and those signings haven't really made a huge difference in the Premier League, at least. And with Spurs in 5th currently, this prediction is still quite healthy. With that attack, they could really balance the team out beautifully with a top shot stopper. Look at what that did for Liverpool when they were unbalanced with great attacking talent but had Loris Karius in goal. Mendy has been good. He was flying at the beginning of his Chelsea career, getting clean sheets for fun. He's made a few mistakes now and then, but certainly has been an improvement overall on Kepa. Chelsea's defense in general has actually been pretty hit or miss recently. I think Chelsea will only climb as high as 3rd place. If only at the moment. I mean, they have the talent to reach much higher than where they currently are in 7th. It's a matter of getting that offense ticking again, and that falls largely on Lampard, but there's also the issue of the attackers being completely out of form, namely Timo Werner. As I noted in a video recently, he still has the most goal involvements in the Premier League of any Chelsea player. That could have changed after the Leicester match that I'm not watching at the moment, but he's nowhere near his best. If he finds form, if Pulisic stays healthy, then Chelsea will shoot up the standings. I have no doubt about that, but this is looking like a poor prediction in this moment. And finally, but even when Liverpool weren't playing very well, they were still getting results. I mean, they only failed to win on 6 occasions last season, 3 draws and 3 losses. 18 matches in and Liverpool are at 7 draws and 2 losses. Just thought I'd throw that in there. I think and hope we will have a proper title race this year. And in this moment, if I was to bet on one team to win it, my funds would feel safest with Liverpool, as City need to cut out their erratic performances before I can really count on them as title favorites again. All right, so I'll leave these standings predictions on the screen for a moment so you can look them over, but there are a couple of things that I can say about this prediction. I obviously made this prediction without the assumption that Liverpool would go through an injury crisis and that they would lose their 2 best center backs so early for so long in Van Dijk and Joe Gomez, forcing, for my money, their best midfielder in Fabinho to play as a center back. So you lose twice there. You lose your best defenders and possibly your best midfielder, at least your best holding midfielder. On top of this, this was made before Ruben Dias signed with Man City, and look at what he has done for that team. He's brought the best out of John Stones, the back line is the best in England, and finally we're seeing City attack like they used to in years past now. They've got the balance at both ends of the pitch. Liverpool and City have sort of moved in opposite directions from when this video was made, partially down to the injuries and the sudden lack of goals for Liverpool, while City are rock solid at the back and finding the goals quite easily again. Overall, the health of these predictions aren't in jeopardy at all. But as past Adrian said, where would my money feel safest at this point in the season? With City. And I'm obviously not trying to pull a fast one on you and change my prediction. Those are set in stone for the internet to see. But at the halfway point, with Liverpool not signing any center backs as of yet, with their attack faltering, and with the form City are trending towards, City seem like title favorites to me now. Respect to United, of course, but we'll see if they can keep it going for the long run. So, that's where my predictions are at. How are yours doing? Do let me know. But beyond that, thanks for watching. My name is Adrian, this is Rabona TV, and we'll see you later in a couple of days. Ciao!